Good afternoon. My name is Moreyra Garlock, and next to me is Sigrid Adriaenssens. And as the organizers of today's event, we welcome you here today. Today we're here to celebrate the works and engineering contributions of one of the world's greatest structural engineers, Fazlur Khan, and we do this through a lecture and an exhibition. But before we move forward with honoring Khan, I want to mention that it is not a coincidence that we plan the theme of the exhibition to be tall buildings, that this exhibition would also debut near the 10th anniversary of 9/11. But our tone and intent for this theme is a positive one, one that celebrates the accomplishments of great engineers, and in our opinion, Mr. Leslie Robertson, the engineer of record of the original World Trade Center, is one of those great engineers that we honor. You can see a video interview of him in the exhibition, along with a video interview of Bill Baker. He is the engineer of the world's tallest building, the Burj Khalifa, and we are honored to have Bill Baker in the audience with us today.
I would like to introduce you to some other special people that are here today. We have Jasmine Khan. Jasmine is the daughter of Fazlur Khan. She's also a structural engineer. We also welcome Robin Goldsmith, the widow of Myron Goldsmith, who was a structural engineer and architect who worked very close together with Fazlur Khan. And another close collaborator of Fazlur Khan, Mark Fintel, who's traveled very far to be with us today. So you will learn more about the collaborations of Fazlur Khan with these people in David's lecture. I would also like to introduce you to you, our Dean Vince Poor. We are very lucky to have Vince as our dean for many reasons, but and one of them is his unwavering support for projects like the exhibition that you're about to see. So, Vince.
Thank you, Sigrid. Good afternoon, and on behalf of the university and the School of Engineering, let me welcome you to this event, and for those of you who came from elsewhere to campus, I'm glad to see that the sun is shining today. It hasn't done that much in the last week or so. You know, engineering often serves as a bridge between scientific knowledge and human aspirations. And I don't think any other field demonstrates this physically like the structural engineering of tall buildings does, which of course is the subject of a lot of what David is going to talk about today. At Princeton, we've been extremely fortunate to have colleagues, including Maria and Sigrid and David, today's speaker, who've been able to demonstrate this role of engineering to students and to the community at large. So today's events, of course, is a prime example of that, and it continues a long tradition of this kind of activity here at Princeton. One of these is, I can't remember exactly the dates, but Swiss Legacy, for which David served as curator, which celebrated the achievements of the modernist Swiss bridge designers of the last century. And this was a wonderful exhibit with models built partly by students that started at the Princeton Art Museum and went around to six other venues. Ultimately residing in the atrium outside here for many years. It reached many people and showed them the beauty of structural engineering and how engineering relates to human aspirations. More recently, we had an exhibit on the achievements of Felix Candela, a great Mexican structural engineer in thin shell concrete. Again, this was curated partly by David and also by Maria. It was initiated at the Art Museum here in Princeton. It's also traveled to MIT and to the Carnegie Museum of Art in Pittsburgh. And again, it's been extremely successful. We also exhibited it outside here for a while, and we hope to bring those back when we can. In addition to these exhibits, we come to today's exhibition, which really continues this what is a long tradition here at Princeton of this kind of interaction between engineering and the arts and human aspirations. Today we have a little bit of a different kind of an exhibit in that this was the result of a course. So this is a course that was taught jointly by Maria and Sigrid. So a lot of what you're going to see afterwards when you see the Khan exhibit is the result of what students did in a course. And this is a course that's going to be ongoing, be celebrating many other structural engineers in the future, and perhaps other engineers, maybe even electrical engineers. I'm an electrical engineer. So anyway, very happy to have you here. Welcome. Hope you enjoy. I'm sure you'll enjoy David's talk, and I look forward to meeting you outside afterwards. So enjoy. Thank you.
Today's lecture is part of the Fazlur Khan Distinguished Lecture Series. So I'd like to introduce to you Professor Dan Frangipal, who is the Fazlur Khan Endowed Chair of Structural Engineering and Architecture at Lehigh University, who will say a few words about these series and introduce our guest lecturer.
Thank you, Maria. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed my privilege and honor to be the initiator and organizer of this lecture series. This lecture series honors the legacy of excellence in structural engineering and architecture of Dr. Fazlur Rahman Khan, one of the most foremost structural engineers and architects of the past century. I have to mention that Professor Lynn Beetle, who was a good friend of Fazlur Khan, established this Fazlur Khan Endowed Chair at Lehigh University. Both they organized and founded the CTUBH. Dr. Lynn Beetle was a recipient of numerous honors and awards. He is the director of the Fritz Engineering Laboratory and the university distinguished professor at Lehigh University. He was also a very good friend with my advisor of the PhD thesis, which was Professor Massonet, in Belgium, and they both contribute a lot to the development of plastic analysis and design of structures. As I mentioned, this lecture series honors a legacy in structural engineering and architecture, and Dr. Fazlur Khan was one of the foremost structural engineers of the 20th century. He epitomized both structural engineering and achievement and creative collaborative effort between architects and engineers. Fazlur Khan was a pragmatic visionary. The series of progressive ideas that he brought forth for the efficient high-rise construction in the 60s and 70s were validated in his own work, such as the John Hancock Center and the 110-story Sears Tower. Unfortunately, he is no longer with us. However, his daughter, Yasmin Khan, is here. I propose to give a big hand to recognize the outstanding contributions of Fazlur Khan and honor his legacy and family. Thank you. As I mentioned, we initiated this lecture series in 2007. Generally, February, March, and April are the months when these lectures are given. All the lectures are recorded, and basically you have the record of these lectures. This was the 2007 series with Mark Sarkisian, Manchu Tang, and Gene Corley. In 2008, we have the pleasure to host Richard Tomasetti, Jeremy Eisenberg, and John Fisher. 2009 was Leslie Robertson, William Baker, who is here also, thank you for coming, and Bruce Ellingwood. In 2010, Zdenek Bajant, Ron Klemenchik, and Jack Breen. And finally, 2011, we had only two in the spring. We wanted to have also Masayoshi Nakashima. He was scheduled to be with us on March 24, but he's a graduate from Lehigh University. He was also the director of the Disaster Prevention Center in Japan, but on March 11, you know, the earthquake comes, the tsunami comes, nuclear power plant disaster camp, he cannot be with us. So he will come after 2 weeks in September 2003. And today we have with us David Billington, and this is a highlight of our lecture series. I'll mention that David Billington is a Gordon Wu Professor of Engineering Emeritus, Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering Emeritus, lecturer with the rank of professor in civil and environment engineering at Princeton University. It will take probably 2 hours to mention everything that David did, but I'll just take only 3 minutes. He graduated from Princeton University in 1950s with a degree in basic engineering. He then won a Fulbright Fellowship and spent 2 years in Belgium to study post-war innovations in bridges and precast concrete structural design. He began in 1952 to work as a designer of structures for Roberts and Schaefer Company consulting engineer in New York City. In 58, he began lecturing at Princeton University and joined the faculty in 1960. He has won many prestigious awards and honors, such as Dexter's Prize for the best book in 79 from the Society of the History of Technology for Robert Maillard Bridges. In 1985, he was elected to the Executive Council of the Society for the History of Technology. In 1986, he was elected to the National Academy of Engineering and won the History and Heritage Award from the American Society of Civil Engineering. He has served as an Andrew White Professor at Large at Cornell University from 87 to 1993. In 1990, he received the Dana Award for Pioneering Achievements in Education. The Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching named him New Jersey Professor of the Year in 1995, and he was named one of the 5 top educators in civil engineering since 1874 by the Engineering News Record in 1999. In 1998, he was elected as fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. In 1999, he was elected honorary member of the American Society of Civil Engineers. He holds an honorary doctorate in human letters from Union College in 1990, an honorary doctorate of science from Grinnell College, and an honorary doctorate of engineering from Notre Dame University. He was a 2003 recipient of the Director Award for Distinguished Teaching Scholars. The Director's Award is the highest honor bestowed by the National Science Foundation for excellence in both teaching and research in science, mathematics, engineering, and technology. In 2006, David Billington was named the Walter R. Robb Senior Engineering Education Fellow of the National Academy of Engineering, and in 2008, he was awarded the Distinguished Award of Merit from the American Council of Engineering Companies. His research includes design and rehabilitation of bridges, thin-shell concrete structures, tall buildings, and concrete dams. Detailed study of the major structural engineers such as Robert Maillard, Félix Candela, Eugene Freycinet, Gustave Eiffel, Othman Oman, Anton Tedesco, Fazlur Khan, Hans Iser, and Christian Mann. He has also been involved in curating exhibitions in the Princeton University Art Museum and the study of politics and engineering of large-scale dams. So today, we have the honor to have David Billington with us, Professor Billington.
I think I'm on live.
Yes.
That's a good idea. Okay, well, thank you for that introduction. it was a very, very kind introduction, and I was happy to speak with the introducer before to find out we were both students in Belgium at different times, but nevertheless, we have that in common. Right? Then he started speaking French to me, and that is, it's a little rusty, my French, but nevertheless, we managed. Now, today, I have my stick, as you know, and get going. And the audience is warned to stay back of the third row. So there's another good reason. You can't see the slides very well without craning your neck in this lap. In any case, the idea of the talk I'm going to give on Fazlur Khan is has three components to it to begin with. First component is how this came to my attention. I mean, a lot of other people knew about him before I really did, but it was a marvelous experience that we were having a conference here in 1972 on Robert Maillard, and I ran into Fazlur the year before, And I will describe that in brief when I get into it. But the point is, the first thing is that we were brought together by this Maiar conference. The second thing is that in understanding what he was doing, which I didn't realize, I'd seen him lecture, but I didn't really, until he came to Princeton and gave a lecture. And he gave a lecture along with, in a session at this conference, with Felix Candela, who's already been referred to, Maria's specialist in that wonderful exhibition. And the third one was Christian Mend, in my view, the greatest living bridge designer. And the three gave a talk, and I realized suddenly that it was possible to give a course on great engineers, great structural engineers. That these three came, and so I'm happy now that we can complete that trip, like that cycle, to deal with now Fazlur Khan. And I want to deal with him in two different ways. One is he is a structural artist. That's the criterion for the course that we teach, that Maria and Sigrid are now gradually taking over, quickly taking over. And in this category of these great structural engineers, Fazlur Khan is unique for the fact that he was, I would say, an exemplary collaborator. And so I want to talk about his collaborations in the beginning of this lecture. And then the second thing, towards the end, I will introduce the idea of the course, and that is that these people were structural artists. They were real artists. They were not architects. They were engineers, pure engineers, but they were creating works because of their aesthetic motivation, creating works of great beauty, which we are able, therefore, to portray in exhibitions, like the one you're going to see, or maybe you've already seen part of it, here in the library, and that we have been able to put in other places, museums and other places. And so these are two important ideas, one, collaboration, and the other, structural art. So let's start with the first slide. And there's Fazlur then, and there are many pictures of him. I'm going to show a few different ones. Next slide. And now, this is the first experience I had with him. In 1961, I came to Princeton, and the chairman said right away, we have to get some really great young person to teach with you. I was the only really structural engineer, not the only one, but it was supposed to start a group. And so I called up Chester Cease, who I knew quite well, who was head of civil engineering at the University of Illinois, a great institution in this country. And I called him up and I said, well, what's your best student? I'd like to try to get him. He said, well, our best student is a guy named Fazlur Khan, but you'll never get him. Well, I said, I'm going to try. So I called up Fazlur Khan, and he was very polite. He said, he thanked me for calling, but he said, I don't want to be an academic. I want to go out and design things. And that was the end of that discussion. The next experience I had with him was this. I was beginning to study aesthetics of structures, and I wrote two absolutely smashing papers. They were marvelous papers, but they were rejected by civil engineering people. And there was a critic that criticized these two papers really harshly. And in fact, not only was it harsh, but it was also correct. And it was a couple of years later that I found out from the editor, these were supposed to be anonymous reviews, of course. He said, no, you know who that was. I said, no, that was Fazlur Khan. So I learned a lot from him already without ever having met him. Slide is the Princeton connection. I heard him in 1971 give a talk, and I invited him to come to Princeton. This is before I knew what he had done to my beautiful papers. And so he agreed, and he came on April 11th, and it was then that we were planning this conference on Maiar. And so he said, I said, well, I'd like to have you come to that. He said, I'd love to come. He said, I was very influenced by Maiar. I want to come. I want to give a talk. Well, I couldn't resist that. So he came, and he gave a talk. And we had published it in a sort of symposium volume, but it should have been published somewhere else. And it will be eventually, for sure. But nevertheless, he gave this talk Felix Candela and Christian Menn. And I realized then, as I've already said, that this was this made it possible to give a course. Next slide. Now, this is one image of the Maiar connection. This is Myron Goldsmith and his wife, I suspect fairly new wife. Is that right?
Yes.
Yes, Robin Goldsmith. And Robin is here with us, so we're delighted to have Robin here. Sadly, Myron is not here. He's no longer with us. But he was one of my dearest friends of all. And they're standing on one of Maiar's bridges in Switzerland, which automatically indicates the tremendous intelligence of these people. The next slide is the cover of the book that was this conference at Princeton. And on the cover, you see, is the Schwanbach Bridge, which is what they're standing on. So, but this is before I knew Myron, and I'm coming back to him in a minute. Now, next slide. All right, so this is Fazlur Khan gave the opening lecture in this symposium we held in October of 1972. And here's his title. I'll just read it. I don't like slides with lots of words on it, but here's a philosophic comparison between Maiar's bridges and some recent concrete buildings. Well, he should have said, he was too modest to say, my buildings. I mean, but that's what came out for sure and is actually true. So he wrote this wonderful paper, and the idea of giving this lecture made me go back and read these kinds of things again, once again, and realize how important that paper was and is. Next slide. Well, here he is, and also in 1972, he was made Engineer of the Year by the Engineering News Record. He was already really quite well known, and so we were lucky to have him here, and I was lucky, really, finally, to meet my most severe critic. next slide. And then when Fazlur died, sadly, in March of 1962, several of us got together and decided we should do something, have a symposium or a session in honor of him at an ASCE meeting. So we did that. And then Myron Goldsmith and I put together a little book, which I brought. Well, anyway, you see it's badly produced here because it's hard to do. It's a little green book, and it was actually published by Lehigh, and it should be republished, I believe. It was a very good book. Not because of what I did, but because of the people in it. Next slide. And that's what I want to now talk about, because this little book represents that collaboration. And it was a kind of collaboration that involved design, teaching, and scholarship. And it's characterized by three people, and that's who I'm going to now go through briefly. Next slide. So the first one is Bruce Graham. Bruce Graham became, I believe, the senior architect at Skidmore, Owens & Merrill. And he was attracted, as I will now show you why, next slide, to Fazlur Khan. So in this little green book, the first article in it is by Bruce Graham. And this is his title, Collaboration in Practice Between Architect and Engineer. So he's talking about the collaboration between himself and Fazlur Khan. Next slide. Now, the first bit of collaboration, as far as I know, and this I haven't done as much research as needs to be done on Fazlur Khan, but this is the Inland Steel Building in the middle 50s, and Fazlur Khan was a very young engineer then, and Bruce Graham wanted to have some expression of structure. He was interested in thinking about the old Chicago school in the late 19th century, and so he designed this building with the steel columns on the outside and then the glass wall on the inside, and that meant the interior structure had to be connected to the exterior structure. It was a complicated connection. It wasn't a natural kind of one, and it's because there's nothing lateral here, you see. And so he asked the people in his staff, anybody could do it, Al Picardi, who was a very good engineer, but was an MIT graduate, and when they had a really tough problem, his tendency was to get a consultant from MIT. And so Graham was going to do that, And then he said, is there anybody around here who thinks they could do it? Well, this young guy put his hand up. It was Fazlur Khan. He said, I think I can do that. And so he did. He figured out how you could do this rather complicated junction. And that impressed Bruce Graham a lot. And it gave him a respect for Fazlur Khan, which many architects and engineers don't get that kind of interaction. Next slide. So what I'm showing you are the buildings now in the little green book, which are those that Bruce Graham singled out as collaborations with Fazlur Khan. This is the Kansas City Insurance Building. Next slide. It's a steel building, actually. This is the Brunswick Building in Chicago. The next slide is the DeWitt Chestnut Building in Chicago. And the next one is the Shell Plaza in Houston. And the next one, I'll come back to these, and this is, of course, the famous Hancock Tower in Chicago. And the next one is the Sears Tower. Now, these were all what Bruce Graham was proudest of as collaborations with Fazlur Khan, design collaborations. And the important thing is that as these progressed, they became more and more expressive of the structure. And that was due to Fazlur Khan. Next slide. All right, now we come to the second person in our story. This is Myron Goldsmith. You've already seen a picture of him. And here is in more mature days when he is sitting there as both as a absolutely first-rate architect. He was originally trained as a structural engineer as well as an architect. And so he was very sympathetic to Fazlur Khan. And what Myron did is, when he came back from San Francisco, where he had been with SOM there, and he'd actually designed some very interesting structures there, he came back and really to SOM as an architect in Chicago and began designing, but he also began teaching at the Illinois Institute of Technology. And there he said to Fazlur Khan in 1962 when they met, he said, you want to come and teach with me? Because I always want to teach with a structural engineer, because they were doing all kinds of engineering, really, projects. They were architecture projects, but they were really based on engineering ideas. And Myron was very interested in that and wanted to get work together with Fazlur in teaching. Next slide. So the second aspect of our collaboration is between Myron Goldsmith and Fazlur Khan in teaching. And they worked a little bit in some structures together, some buildings together in SOM, but the remarkable thing is the work together they did in teaching at IIT. And the next slide. Here is Myron Goldsmith's first collaboration. This is with his advisor, the very famous Mies van der Rohe, Ludwig Mies van der Rohe, and who was then head of the School of Architecture at Illinois Institute of Technology. And Myron is sitting there talking about his thesis. These were hard to reproduce, but this is a sort of a super frame. And what Myron is really doing is he's really doing a structural thesis for Mies van der Rohe. I don't think Mies ever had another person doing something like that. But Myron was very interested in exploring structural expression. Next slide. And here is a series of these buildings. And you can see the last one here is something that then Fazlur Khan got interested in. And the next slide is a 1964 project with the Japanese architect Sasaki, who was then a student at IIT. And here they were. This was one of the first collaborations between Myron and Fazlur. And they were interested in exploring this kind of thing, which comes directly from Myron's thesis. But Myron was really interested in trying this out on Fazlur and get together with what the structural possibilities were for such a thing. And of course, this led to the famous Hancock Tower directly. In other words, there was a lot of what they were doing at SOM was being tried out by Myron and Fazlur in IIT with graduate students. And so it was a an interesting kind of collaboration, and one which was extraordinarily fruitful in the results in the designs of buildings. Next slide. And here are some of the other, just to give you a small sense. There's a beautiful book just published about the collaborations at IIT between engineers and architects. Very interesting, a very beautiful book. And this just shows you some of the others. These are some of these were steel and some of these were concrete buildings that they were exploring. Next slide. And one of the last ones, 1982, was of course just before Fazlur died. They were exploring these big tall buildings, different ways of reinforcing them on the outside. Next slide. And then in Myron's article, I've taken these from Myron Goldsmith's article in this green book. He has this as his last one. This marvelous, extraordinary, brilliant building. And I'll show you what the engineering view of it is. Next slide. Everything Khan has had an enormous practicality, unlike that Hong Kong monster. This is what happened to this kind of idea of structure and architecture. There's a names for it. I don't know, postmodern. There's all kinds of names. I don't pretend to talk directly about architecture, but this is what the response that Fazlur had. He wrote this too. This is actually written by Bill LeMessurier, but by Fazlur or by Myron, they were all aghast at what was going on here. This is an extraordinarily impractical, wrong structure. But it got to be very famous, of course, because it was new and different. Yes, well, okay. Next slide. Okay, now the third collaborator in this triumvirate here is the collaborator in scholarship. And this is a remarkable person, and he's here. Mark, where are you? There we are. We're going to hear a little bit from him later on. One of our leading engineers, one of our leading civil engineering practitioners in this country, and he worked intimately, closely with Fazlur Khan, which is a great credit to Khan and also to Mark, that they were able to do this, work together on these buildings, and get, as Mark says in his talk, he wrote the third paper in this little green book, wrote about new forms in concrete, and these forms were in part a result of new ideas about the detailing and about the interconnections of concrete members in a new way in big, tall, important urban buildings. Next slide. Just to try to give you a sense, this is an important book, a handbook of concrete engineering, which was a pioneering text by Mark Fintel, which was used widely throughout the country. it's an indication of his prominence. He worked many years for the Portland Cement Association, which had an excellent technical group. Next slide. Now, this is right from his lecture. And what he's trying to show here is that he's very interested in details and very interested in concrete. Because this is actually from the Brunswick building that we've seen. But what he's pointing out here is that in this detail, you could just bring those columns down clunk into this big transfer girder, but instead they're spread like this. And so it's an attention to detail, which also has a structural meaning, not a major one in this case, but still it has a structural meaning, and it's a fine kind of example of Khan and Fintel. Next slide. And here are several buildings. Again, this is directly from Fintel's paper in the green book. This is the Walker Building, or 2 Shell Plaza in Houston, with this kind of, attention to detail at the base. Next slide. And the Marine Midland Bank Building has another name now in Rochester, New York, and again has a lower part, since it's spreading the load from the columns that are coming down evenly to just a few columns at the base, and it's done partly by changing the size of these columns and also by undulating the walls, and that was an interest to both Mark Fintel and Fazlur Khan. Next slide. And that occurs here in this building. This is one Shell Plaza. This is also in Houston. I showed it already. It appears in all the people who are writing about him, include this building. And the next slide is two details. I won't try to go in detail on these, but the point is that this was worked out. This is, again, from Mark Fintel's paper, and showing how this is looking down for one quarter of the building. You're looking down on it at one floor, and you see how the columns are coming out like that. And that caused certain problems in the sense that the columns would have different stresses in them, and therefore, under under temperature, they would move differently. And that was an important problem. To get that effect, which was technically interesting and correct, nevertheless unusual, it also was required to have a clear analysis of how the temperature on the outside in different size members would affect those members. And if they moved differently, there could be substantial cracking. And down below, you see here a cross-section of the building with the external wall is here, and the internal columns, you see the big ones there in the middle, and then the internal shear wall. And so this is, for the engineer, for the specialist engineer, it's a brilliant idea about this. And this is the kinds of things that the engineer scholar, Mark Fintel, worked with Khan on in these buildings. So although that you don't see some of that in the outside, these were essential features to what Khan was doing. Next slide. Here's another view of the same thing, showing those columns. This is a model, of course, but showing those columns coming out. It's an unusual, gives an unusual appearance to the structure, much more interesting than just zoom, zoom, zoom. Next slide. Then the last one that last two that Mark shows are these diagonally braced columns, which of course partly come out of his work with Goldsmith. But here Mark is treating these as part of the collaboration in the in the scholarship. And next slide is the last. This is a model that Mark is showing as the last picture in his lecture and his talk on, these were also lectures, in the little green book. Next slide. So these three people characterize for us the collaboration of Fazlur Khan, and of all our structural artists, he's the one who exemplifies this more than any other that we know about. Now, we're coming next then to the second basic idea, and that is the idea of structural art. And what is structural art? And what I'm showing you here is an idea of Fazlur Khan's to build a composite structure, to build part of it in steel, and then just with a very skeletal part of steel, and then surround that with concrete so that the building was essentially a concrete building reinforced with very light steel girders and beams. And this meant that not only was it a practical design, but it was also practical construction. And so when the designer is thinking and has a strong motive or a builder's mentality, we can call him a master builder, somebody who is thinking not just about the design and how it's going to behave when it's finished, but also how it works as you build it, so it can be done economically. And this is an example of this building. It's partly done. Now the steel is up, and then, next slide, and they will then put the next layer on and build more steel up so that the steel becomes, in a way, the scaffolding for the concrete construction. And this was a brilliant idea of Khan's, which is now used quite generally in many tall buildings. Next slide. And this shows you, well, it's hard to see these details, but this is the column here, what you see up the top, and this beam here. And the steel, if you look down here, this is the vertical steel, this little piece here, and then the horizontal beams are also steel, but the concrete, it's really a concrete building, as you can sort of get an idea from this sketch. Next slide. And this is where it looks. And what we can say is it's a fine building, it's a fine looking building, but it's not a great work of structural art. It wasn't intended that way. It was intended to be an economical way to build based on also a very brilliant design idea at the same time. Next slide. So now we come to this idea of structural art, and it's an idea which requires these three things. First, the designer. Second, the builder's mentality. And if an engineer has both of these, then we can call him quite properly a master builder. The structural artist must have a third characteristic, that is a strong aesthetic motivation. And that gives the master builder, then with the strong aesthetic motivation, we have the right to call him a structural artist. And Khan was certainly a structural artist. There's no doubt about his strong aesthetic motivation. And he wrote about this. He shows it in the buildings that he worked on. now we look just briefly, next slide, into one of his classic ideas. This is a diagram which he was, which his diagram. I captured the slides of his lecture he gave at Princeton, so I have all his slides, I mean a copy of them, and this is one of them. And those of you who are engineers know about this, but the whole idea was, and that's the Hancock Tower represents that, the whole idea of a tall building is you're suddenly going to be confronted, particularly in Chicago, with very high winds. And those high winds, if they're not properly taken count, will cause you to build a lot more structure just to carry the winds in addition to the gravity loads. And what Khan is showing is if you design it properly, you don't have to count, don't have to take into account the wind. And that's what he meant by this. It's just as if you put a dome around the building and all the loads it had were just gravity loads and not loads that required attention to the wind. I'm not going to go into the details of that, but it was an important idea. The concept is very important. And we use this diagram, incidentally, to show that a structure that that needs the wind can be made in a form. So if you look at this diagram like this, that you see the curved up there, if you just split that and did it on both sides and turn it up, you have the Eiffel Tower, which is, of course, fundamentally a wind-loaded structure. And on the other hand, if you take what Khan is doing here, where you just, this is the unit cost, and so you have a very high building, the unit cost doesn't change much, and that is an image like that of the Washington Monument, which is a very slightly changed, but very not very much, because it's so heavy that the wind doesn't affect it. Next slide. All right, so here's another picture of Fazlur Khan. He was, I think, quite photogenic, and he has that look. It's a sort of a serious look, but I think behind it, at least I read it in there as a kind of a playful look as well. He was both serious and playful. Next slide. And here is the Inland Steel, the first building he really had something to do with. And next slide is the tallest building he had something to do with. And he and Bruce Graham had fun saying that this building, the first one they worked on, is exactly the same size as the little part up at the top of the Sears Tower, or the Willis Tower, as it's now called. It was exactly, you put the Inland Steel building up there on the top, and you get the idea, they go from one to the other. Next slide. And just to show you the thinking that went into the Sears Tower, here's a diagram of it with this sort of nine units that are cut off at different locations. But again, that this had to be thought out by the designer how you're going to build it. And they were always working with developers, and the cost was a very important feature, next slide, of most of these buildings. So this idea of how it was built, next slide, this is an important configuration, and all of the outside was made up of these units, and next slide shows one of them, of these units, and then they were built in a factory, and they were shipped out, and the whole thing was assembled. So it thought out, not just, here's the design, build it. But here's the design, and we work with you and figure out how it could be built economically. Next slide. And so that's the tallest building that they did. And now what I want to show in near the end, I want to show, which is part of Fazlur Khan's Princeton lecture, and that is what might be called the Chamber of Horrors. You've already seen one example of it in Myron Goldsmith's writing, and now I'm going to show you what Fazlur showed, and this was, he showed it, and you could almost see him shuddering as he showed this, these pictures. These are horrible structures. Next slide. The Merchandise Mart in Chicago. Now, this great big monolith would easily fit into the Sears Tower, and you would have much lighter, much more space, and he thought that this was a horrible example of very poor design. Next slide. This one he loved to critique. He said, you build a very tall building, and the top third of it is useless. It has bells in it, so you could call it a belfry, but he thought there were some bats there and in the design as well. But anyway, this building is rather famous because it was different. You know, you make it different and you get on the cover of some magazines. Next slide. And the last one is this glorious one that he found. These are his slides found outside of Madrid somewhere. He showed this as some contortion that he thought was awful. So part of Khan was, and part of the teaching was, that there are great examples, and you have to understand why they're great when you compare it to some that are not great. And next slide. And here is the first slide he showed in this Princeton lecture. This is you can see what's happened to my memory, but Hartford, that's it. It's the Hartford building in Chicago, and he doesn't say explicitly how he did it, but it is where he worked on it with, I think, Bruce Graham, and maybe even Myron, but it's one in which the structure is on the outside, clearly. It's not a tall building, and therefore the idea of really bringing out the behavior of it is not here. It's all just one single law, a single plan. But he showed this as an example of something that appealed to him early in his career. And then next slide. It was this slide that he showed, which really amazed all of us when we saw it. I'd never heard of the building. It's in Rochester, New York. It's not in Chicago. It wasn't a famous building. And this is his slide. It could be better, the slide, but this idea of making the structure so you have these wide columns, and then making this inside of it a kind of an impressionistic painting type thing. As the further you get away from it, suddenly an arch appears here. I mean, it's a marvelous idea, and it's a pure engineering idea. It's not something faked up by anybody, but it's a pure idea, beautiful idea. He did several of these, which were, of course, with Bruce Graham, the architect, but the idea here was clearly Fazlur's to do this sort of thing. Next slide. And so coming back now to this kind of a diagram, which I believe is characteristic of Fazlur Khan, and the idea that simple buildings, that ordinary buildings, buildings not even, you see the difference between the Hartford one and this one is not their size, it's the play of the form that makes it so unique and so interesting, and still it was done economically. This was not a question of doing something fancy that was going to cost a pile of money, but people would say, ooh, and that was not what he was after at all. And so next slide is the last one I'll show of him. And when I visited, I was trying to collect materials on him, and I had nice discussions with his wife, Lizalotta, and she took me up to this was his bedroom, their bedroom in their condominium on the North Shore, and he had given her the requirement that he wanted one so that in the bedroom they could see both the Hancock and the Sears Towers. So here's the view, next slide. She allowed me to take this picture. So there's the Hancock, there's the Sears Tower. We don't care about this in the stuff, we could just tear those down, but just to see Fazlur Khan and the images of Chicago and now of other places too, this great figure in our story of master builders, structural artists, and great collaborators. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Billington. This is just a modest sign from Lehigh University for honoring your lecture.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I'll give you back. Honoring your presence.
Thank you.
Okay. Put it down here.
Do you accept questions?
I always accept questions.
Okay. So if there are questions.
Yes, sir.
Chris Letchford from RPI. David, would you like to comment on the new Erie building in New York City that has folding facade?
On the building designed by the architect Frank Gehry?
Well, I think it's a Gehry building, yes.
I make it a point not to pretend that I'm an architectural critic. So I never try to make architectural judgments of something like that. Of course, it has no meaning structurally. His buildings have no meaning whatsoever structurally. But that may be all right. That's not a criticism of architecture. If you ask me to criticize the structures, that's a different story. But I have my own opinions, like everybody else does. And in this room, I think we have mixed company. We have a high quality of discussion, so I won't give my opinions.
I think you just did. Any other questions? If not, take one more person.
In the new building that's going up at One World Trade Center, getting to see a lot of the construction of that, what is your opinion of the efficiency of that building from a construction standpoint?
I can't say that I've really paid too much attention to it, so I couldn't give. I think it's probably pretty good. I mean, most of the buildings in New York that are built are quite efficient, quite economical. But I don't know about that. I assume it is. I don't follow that closely, unfortunately. Good question, though. Okay.
Yes.
When you studied Kant, did you ever come across any of his ideas that got buried just on paper somewhere that never made it into reality? And if so, can you talk about those?
Well, I think a lot of the things that he and Myron did at IIT were sketches of various sorts, and this book that Robin actually sent me recently shows a lot of interesting buildings, not just high-rise buildings, but long-span buildings as well. And I think there were a lot of those very suggestive that could be followed up. I mean, I think that kind of thing should be studied by academics, anyway, to try to get into the idea of teaching about projects that are serious. I mean, all those projects that Fazlur and Myron did together were serious projects. So there are a lot like that, I think, some of them are actually published now in this book. So that's a good question. And I don't know, but just to answer something else, I don't know whether he ever sat down and did sketches. I mean, most structural artists don't do that sort of thing. I mean, they did it because they were teaching, and it was a wonderful thing to do. But most people like Meyer, for example, he never made sketches for anything. I mean, he made a few little drawings on the train while he was thinking, but they tend not to do that sort of thing. Architects do it beautifully, I think, but engineers don't normally do that. Yes, some other question? Yes.
I visited Shanghai last year. I wonder what Fazlur would have thought about the explosion of peculiar and very fantastic architecture in downtown Shanghai after the elegant and beautiful structures created in Chicago?
Well, it's a good question. I think those are the kinds of things should be looked at critically and compared with other things. I'm almost completely ignorant of those things. I see pictures of them, but the tendency to make some fancy-looking thing is a great tendency because it gets on the cover of journals and things and magazines. But I think the little image I showed in Myron's talk of that Hong Kong bank is an indication, and I know Fazlur felt the same way about that. And I think if he had seen more of what was being built, I have a feeling he would have been like he was with my papers. I think he would have been a real critic, a really wonderful critic of those. It's difficult when you're a practitioner to be a critic of someone else's work. An academic should be able to do that, though. And there should be more of that. I think it's a good question.
You know,
as you get older, you have a selective memory. So I have them. I think I saved them, and I do treasure them. And since I found out who was criticizing them, but his criticisms were so good, and were so important to me. It's hard for me to remember precisely what he said, except that the writing was bad, that's clear. But the idea of, you know, when you start out trying, if you're an engineer and you're really trained as an engineer, practice engineer, and you haven't really thought about aesthetics, and then you get down and you go all excited, you know, oh gosh, this is wonderful, then it comes across very clearly as being of little value. And people who write about it, unless they really kind of have some kind of a basis for studying that. You know, people mostly think aesthetics, well, you know, it's all in the eye of the beholder, or if it's efficient, it's going to be beautiful, all kinds of nonsense like that. And you have to go way beyond that in it. And in structures, I think we have tried to start to do that. And one of the ways of doing it is exactly what these young ladies have done, is to take buildings, give them to students, work with them, and then build models and show them. It's in a way, that's a kind of an exercise in extremely good work, both the actual structures themselves and in the building of them by the students. So I think that's a really important feature of getting the aesthetic motivation into engineering. It's a hard thing. It's a hard task. Most engineers don't believe there's such a thing. So we're working with that, right? Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
David mentioned that one of the collaborators of Fazlur Khan was Mark Fintel, and I was told that Mark is to say something. And I invite you.
Here's the clock from the high university. It's one clock.
Oh, yes.
First of all, thank you for inviting me to commemorate my dear friend Fazlur Khan. While a lot of technical talk you heard about the buildings and things, and I will say a few words about Fazlur Khan, the man and the friend. We met Fazlur initially when there was problem at the foundation of John Hancock. He called me up at the Portland Cement Association, which is the organization that I worked, an organization that solved problems in concrete construction. The problem was at that time that some of the caisson was completed, and they counted up the amount of concrete that went into it, and it proved to be there is more concrete than there should that to fill the caisson. So they drilled and found out that there is a big empty spot in the middle of the 100-foot caisson. And at that time, Fazlur called me up and asked for advice how to handle the problem and fill the 5 feet empty spot. After several kind of conversations that we had with Fazlur at the time, we found out that we had enough commonality between the two of us. We both have a similar kind of world view. We both were new immigrants in this country. Fazlur came from Bangladesh in order to complete his PhD. I came from Israel in order to live the American life. And both of us have in mind the possibility of reaching the American dream. Both of us did, thanks God. Initially, our friendship related to technical problems or other kind of conversations, but very soon it kind of cemented itself in a friendship that lasted the entire time as Fazlur was here alive. The relationship kind of also cemented by our spouses. Fazlur Khan had a Liesl wife, an Austrian woman. Myself and my wife were Israelis from Israel. After a number of kind of get together, we really created a such basic friendship that we constantly went to each other's dinners, and we constantly found together ways to entertain. And it was a wonderful period of our lives and Fazlur and Liesl's wife together. I would like to stress that is in those two families, we found that we are members of three different religions. Fazlur was Muslim, Liesl, his wife, was Christian, and we were Jewish. Mm-hmm. And we really created such a wonderful, wonderful togetherness that it lasted and enriched our lives for many and many years. By the way, I would like to stress that Fazlur died on his pilgrimage to Hajj, to Mecca, and died in Mecca of a heart attack, similar way as his father died on a heart attack. So it was kind of a genetic problem. And again, I will keep for the time of our life the deep friendship and the deep togetherness that we had with Fazlur. Thank you.
So I'm the last one to speak. I know you're all dying to get a glass of wine, but I do want to talk a little bit about the exhibition you're going to see, which is, as our dean said, is the result of a class that Maria and I had last fall. In David's talk, David talked about how structures come about not just by doing engineering calculations, but how they come about by thinking about how they would be constructed. About they come about in a certain social political context, and they have to last a long time. The business that we are in, the objects that we design, buildings or bridges, they don't last 1 year or 10 years. They're supposed to last 50, 100, 200 years. So the durability aspect is very important. And in a lot of engineering curricula, this is completely not addressed. And so Maria and I, we're trying to set out to develop a course that would address some of these issues. And so we designed this course called A Social and Multidimensional Exploration of Structures, which we managed to due to the 250th anniversary fund. It was a course where were mostly senior students that participated, and we were looking at exemplary structures. We wanted to the students to look at, first of all, the spatial dimensions, not only look at two dimensions. Mostly in structural engineering, people do two-dimensional analysis. We wanted to look at the students look at the structures in three dimensions, but also in the fourth dimension of time. And of course, if you want to go and see how a structure weathers through time, you can't really do this from images. You have to go on site. So part of the course was going on site visits to see how structures weather with time, but also how communities kind of adopt the structures. Then we wanted the students to study the social, the political, and economic context in which structures come about, because of course, as engineers, we kind of don't work in isolation. We work in a certain time frame, in a certain context. So it's important to understand what are the driving forces that are acting at a moment that kind of make the push for certain structures happen. As David mentioned, constructability is very important. It's not because when you draw something on paper that it will stand up. It's only when you start thinking about how things are going to be connected, how they're going to be built, you really start making a link between calculations and design and constructability. And so the way that we thought we could do this is by having students make models. By making models, students have to think about how are they going to put the columns and the beams and the plates and the facade together. So that was going to be an important part of our new course. Also, we wanted our students to improve their engineering skills of calculation, so both back of the envelope calculations as well as more advanced numerical analysis. And we wanted them to develop their communication skills. Our students become professionals. They will go out in practice. They will have to deal with other professionals, architects, landscapes, designers, but they will also have to deal with clients who are not necessarily versed in engineering terms. So they have to bring their quite specialist knowledge in a language that the layman, the client, or a policymaker can understand. So these were kind of the objectives that we tried to achieve in this course. This course runs every 2 years. As Maria's mentioned before, we choose every year a theme. The theme that we chose this academic year was tall buildings, because we knew the 10th anniversary of 9/11 was going to come up. And we focused on Fazlur Khan, because he is for us really the structural engineer who pushed kind of the structural expression in tall buildings. So this is an engineering course looking at the use of case studies. Now, this is a bit uncommon in engineering education. In, of course, as you know, in medical school or law school or architecture or art, they study precedents. In engineering, this is not so commonly done. And of course, our students will, when they are out in practice, they will not exactly encounter the same context that Fazlur Khan was dealing with. But by studying him and by studying his collaborations, his works, and the way he approached design, they will be able to draw on that and use that in any kind of professional situation that they're in. The format of our course was studio-based, so basically we met twice a week for a couple of hours, and the students were supposed to do most of the work during those hours. A studio-based is a pedagogical approach that's very much used in architecture. And basically, the students are supposed to work. We think that they learn best when they are tackling open-ended problems. So we didn't lecture and then set problems. They were basically working in groups. They were studying one of the structures of Fazlur Khan. They were doing analysis. They were writing about it. They were making models. And so we would go around and see whether there were any questions, or we would ask them questions. We also had regular reviews of their work, and we also had many very prominent speakers, such as you see here on the slide. This is Jasmine visiting us. She was one of our first speakers, and she shared with us. She talked about her father, but also about his works. And so prior to when the speakers were coming, the students were preparing their visit. So what you see actually on the table is Jasmine Khan, but on the table you see articles that the students are supposed to read for the next speaker, which is it's an article on Bill Baker. So we also had Bill Baker coming. So the students were reading these articles or books before the speakers were coming, and they would compile a list of questions that they were going to ask. And so we had I think, quite impressive list of speakers. We had Jasmine Khan, we had Bill Baker, who told us about principles of tall building design. We had Leslie Robertson, the original structural designer of the World Trade Center. Guy Nordenson, a critic of tall buildings, who also had a tall building exhibition at the MoMA. Esther da Costa-Meyer, who talked about the historical context of Fazlur Khan's work. And of course, David Billington, who talked about structural art. And of course, in buildings, structural art is a very complex issue because you are right at the at the boundary with architecture. As you see also on the slide, so our students prepared interviews and then interviewed our speakers in very professional settings here at Princeton University. So you see here Marianne, Elizabeth, and Jeremy preparing to interview Bill Baker. Now, all these interviews, you can see them in the exhibition. We have a small multimedia screen where you can stroll, and all the interviews are there. There are some headphones that you can listen to, and some, I think, very interesting things were said in these interviews. Then, as I mentioned, we also went on site visits. So the idea of a site visit was not only to go and see the structure and see how it had weathered, see how it was constructed, but we also met with engineers that had worked on the projects together with Fazlur Khan. We met with developers, we met with clients, we met people that were actually living in those buildings. And it was really quite amazing how keen people were to show us. I got a real sense that people were really proud of the buildings they had worked on or the buildings that they had lived in. Now, prior to going on these visits, we had asked the students to prepare a little text, and maybe you can put it up. Yeah. The students worked in groups of two or three people on one building of Fazlur Khan, and they had to prepare a little text which explained the socio-political context, the structural significance, how the structure had weathered, and any other significant text. We then collected all these essays and also other essays and assembled them into a little travel booklet. The idea was that when we went on our site visit, they could put that in their pocket and they could read about the structures. And so you will also find this travel booklet on our website. So if you ever go to Houston or New York or Chicago, we have big description of all tall buildings in here. And so basically when we went to see the buildings, the students who had worked on the building, they would start explaining to the other students what this building was about. Now it was very interesting because I think for the students this was a very good exercise in explaining something quite complicated in quite simple terms, but we also had people stopping on the pavement to come and listen to what these students were actually, and we had one person stopping in a car to come and listen what these students are saying. So we see here Alex and Megan explaining the engineering behind Tusha Plaza. We also went to New York, where we went to the office of Rosenwasser, and we met with an engineer who had worked with Fazlur Khan on the design of 780 Third Avenue in New York, the building you see on the left-hand side, and which David has also shown. We also had the fortune, of course, going to Chicago, where we saw the Hancock Center, the Sears Towers, Entry, and we were very well received at SOM, the home office of Fazlur Khan. We met with some of colleagues of Fazlur Khan who kindly or fondly kind of brought up memories from him. But I think these visits to these engineering offices were also very fruitful for our students, because I think this was the first time that they were starting to think of themselves that they maybe could be working in such an office. I think up to then, their studies maybe had been a little bit abstract, and the idea of what an engineer actually does and what his office workplace actually looks like had been quite abstract. So it was very interesting when we went to the offices, the students were asking the practitioners, you know, what would you recommend us to do if you want to come and work in an office like this? What universities should we go to? And so I think for the students, it was a real, these visits to these offices were a real eye-opener. Okay, so here, this, we're still in Chicago. This is Meg and Jasmine explaining in the Brunswick building how the forces travel through these tiny columns onto the transfer girder, onto the bigger columns. And of course, part of the site visit was also that they had to collect information that they didn't have yet, because they had to make a model. And so the next slide you will see is Meg and Yasmin working on their model. Now, these are students who have never built models. So the models you will see in the exhibition are the models that these students made in one semester. They had never made models before. For the course, we purchased a laser cutter, a digital cutter. So they were kind of forced to use quite advanced equipment to make these models. And I think they were very, I mean, you will be able to judge yourself when you see the exhibition exhibits. But I think the models are very beautifully crafted, and I think the students have done a really good job. Also, when we got the course evaluations, the students saw the site visits and as well the model making as a very valuable experience. Okay, so I think this, so the models are in the exhibition, you're about to go and see it. We are very happy to say that this small exhibition is already on the route of engineering tours of prospective students. They go to the engineering library, and students get to see this as an example of what they could be doing when they come to Princeton University. This exhibition will also be used in a much larger course, 262 Structures in the Urban Environment, where we have an enrollment of 100 to 200 people, not necessarily engineers, but also people from the liberal arts who will be studying these objects when they are studying the works of structural art. And I think also when you go and see it, you will probably be able to see that these structures, when they are efficient, elegant, economic, that they can be real pieces of art. So that's the end of my talk. I invite you to go and have a glass of wine and to have a look at the exhibition. Thank you.